So, yeah, I was at Wawa getting my meditational coffee and breakfast sandwich when I got a phone call from Pastor saying that he was having a battle with his stomach this morning, and his stomach won. So he decided that he would stay home to rest and recuperate. But he wanted me to show everybody that he will be at his Wednesday devotional. So he expects to see everybody who's usually there at the Wednesday devotional. So what we're going to do today is worship God, because we should be doing it every day, but especially today with us in a corporate setting, we should come together and worship God and be thankful for all that he has done for us and is continuing to doing for us. At this time, we're going to move right along our opening song, which is "Come Now Is the Time to Worship," because it is the time to worship. Yes. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for giving us the strength to wake up this morning and to make the decision to come to praise and worship you. Father, we ask that you spread your healing hands across this country as young ones and teenagers are heading back to school, and with all the problems that we're hearing across the country of shootings and such, pray that you'll be with those families and you'll be with those children as they try to increase their education and their knowledge. And we pray that you will protect them as they do so. We ask that you be with our pastor, Pastor Stephen, as he recovers. We pray that his recovery will be swift and he will be back again with us very soon. And we also ask, Father, that we all realize that this is your kingdom and that we are your ambassadors, your servants here to live out and spread your word throughout this world. And whether it be internationally or whether it's just passing out food to those who need it on a Sunday afternoon, Father, we pray that your message will reach them and let them know that you are our Heavenly Father who cares for us and who will never abandon us. And we pray these things in the words that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. While I was having my meditational coffee this morning, and just before Pastor called me, I was listening to this pastor who was talking about how a lot of people pray and hope for God's kingdom after death, meaning that we're going to this great place in the sky where we will be with Jesus and we will be with him, which I believe that is true. But the one thing that I don't think that we should ever forget is that the kingdom that we should be worrying about is here on earth. We just prayed a prayer, and it said, Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. So I think we need to be careful and make sure we realize that we need to focus on the kingdom here on earth, that we have to build the kingdom here on earth. Yes, I understand that when that time comes and we all pass away, that we will be greeted by Jesus and our Father, you know, at that time. But that is not our main purpose for choosing to live the way we live, to follow Jesus Christ. We're doing that to hopefully influence other people so that God's kingdom be realized here on earth, because we are his ambassadors here on earth. So I thought that was a point. I didn't know I'd be using that today, but that's the way God works sometimes. So we want to remember that His kingdom come and His will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. And with that being said, although I'm sure most of you have done this already, want everybody to stand up and turn around and greet everybody that's here, because we are brothers and sisters in Christ. So we want to welcome everybody here. Wave to the people up on social media. Keep drinking that coffee. Keep drinking that coffee. Brother, how are you doing? Right. And in Pastor Stephen's famous words, as we return to our seats, I wanted to say that so bad. I've been waiting to say that. Yes, as we return to our seats, I wish you the peace of God. May the peace of God be with you. Okay, we're going to try that again. May the peace of God be with you. Amen, amen. Joyce, would you do us the honors of blessing the offering?
Father God, thank you so much for everything you do for us every day. Thank you, Lord, for providing us daily with the things that we need. And thank you so much, Lord, that we have some to give back to your church, to your missions, to your people. Please guide us as we use them to the best of our ability. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Lean on the everlasting arms. Oh, how great.
What I wanted to do today was I wanted to allow you, my brothers and sisters, congregation here, to share with each other. Share a testimony, a time when you relied on God to see you through something, whatever it is. A time when you thought that maybe he wasn't real. A time when you doubted, but in the end he came through for you. So if I have anybody here today that has a testimony that would like to share, I would ask you to come up to that mic and share with your brothers and sisters how God has been with you from day to day. Kyla, you wanna? Come on up.
Good morning, church. Good morning. I'm gonna try to get through this without crying, but as everybody knows, and you know, all the regulars here, my dad passed in 2020. And before that, I told everybody, like, because my dad had underlying health issues, and but I always told everyone, you know, he was my favorite person in the whole wide world. So when he passed, it was a really rough time for me. And I also tell people after I got out of that initial deep grief, because when the memorial service is over and the person has been cremated and you spread ashes and everything, the calls stop sometimes, text messages stop, the checking up on you stops. All that I had was God. He saw me through. I don't think that, and not to be like deep or, you know, like dark, but I don't think I would be here without God. So, and therapy, but God as well. And I guess that's it.
Thank you so much for sharing. Amen. Anybody else? We have anybody else who wants to share? Would you like to share? Okay.
Good morning, church. My name is
Good morning.
My name is Joyce. I know I'm almost all crying. That's why I got tissue. Okay, in 2002, I was involved in a car accident. My coworker came to get me. We was on our way to work. Somebody stole a van and hit us. So since then, I've been having a problem with my back. Well, before then, I was working for UPS during Christmas time, so I injured my back. So it made it worse. So I had to go to physical therapy and everything. So I had to stop working because my work, I was lifting and bending and cleaning, so it was hard for my back. So 23, nobody but God. When I said God come through, he come through, he show up and he show out. I was in the shelter the whole year. My mother and them said, you don't have to go in the shelter. I said, no, I want to go in the shelter. So me and my husband can have our own place. So I want to do it. My family said, no, you don't have to, but I did. I went in the shelter, stayed a whole year. And I was going to church. I was praying. It was just, then my husband, he was missing. So it was a lot on me. I had suicide thoughts and everything, but I was talking to my church family, and you know, I isolated myself, so, because I didn't want to be bothered. I want my, nobody trying to help me find my husband, so I isolated myself. When I tell you, God did a 360 in my life. September, I had a job coach. She said, do you want to start working? Do you want to work again? I'm like, yes, because I've been trying to apply for a disability. They kept saying, you can work. I said, well, how can I work? I got a lot of health issues. Oh, you can work, you can stand up. I said, how can I stand up if I have a problem with my back? It hurts my, and my legs swell up because I have a lot of health issues like diabetes, it's just a lot. So I kept getting denied and I was depressed over that. So I had a job coach. I said, no, I'm gonna start working. So at first she said, you won't work in the post office. I said, no, that's a lot of walking. It's still a lot of standing. I said, I have experience in cleaning. And she said, you sure you want to do that? I said, yes, I'll do it again. She said, so, okay, you're going to get this job because I know somebody that works in Fort Bev. I know the boss. So I said, okay. September the 11th, I went on an interview and everything. It was the boss and the two supervisors. So, and my job coach. So we were sitting at this table. So they say, why do you want to work here? I said, because I love people. I'm a people person. I love cleaning. So she asked me how will I do the cleaning. So she said, so at the end, what do you want? I said, I want to level up. All of them start laughing, right? They said, that's one of the questions that got you the job. They said, we love your answers. So I started working September 11th. My husband, when was that? Was that like in? Yeah. Okay, August the 1st, my husband, he was found safe. So I told him, I started working September 11th. I prayed. I was fasting and praying with my church. I was going to church. I'm like, I don't feel like none of y'all helped me. God helped me. When I said God stepped in, we got an apartment. We got approved for the apartment down here. My husband was found, and I started working. When I said God did a 360 in my life, I said, God, nobody but you. So every day when I get up, I give him all the glory, honor, the praise, because nobody but God. I talk to him through the day. My supervisor say, you crazy, who are you in there talking to? I said, I'm talking to my Heavenly Father, because I'm just thanking him. So when I go to work, I be in pain, but I go and I do it. I've been there September 11th, I'll be there a year. So when God is awesome. So can nobody tell me that it's not a God? Can nobody tell me that you got to have faith, you got to believe, and you got to trust? Because without that, God said, if you have a faith of a size of a mustard seed, I said, no, my faith is big. It's big. So that's my testimony. My trials and tribulations turn out to be beautiful testimonies. Thank you all for letting me share.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Anybody else? Don't be bashful. We're brothers and sisters here. And God just loves it when you give him glory. Yes. He really does. He loves it when he sees that you realize that he matters. That's what he wants. And he wants you to make that decision. He's not going to make you. He wants you to make that decision. That's what that free will thing is all about. You know. Anybody? Wow. It's quiet in here. I can see them. I see the brains just like, I can see everybody's brain just twirling. Well, I'll share a little something. My mother passed in 2020. At the height of the whole COVID thing. She didn't die of COVID, but she was 84. And during that time, everything was shut down. So everything took twice as long. It took like 3 weeks for the funeral, and then it was like another 3 weeks to actually bury her, because once we had the funeral, we couldn't just take her to the cemetery, because she had to make an appointment. So then they held on to the body, and you know, not so much myself, because I was down here. My sister, who actually lived two doors from my mother, she was there handling everything. I mean, literally handling everything. So we had that. And then, of course, everything that you had to do, everything that should have taken like nowadays would took like a couple of days, multiply it by like three or four times. Like there was certain paperwork that had to be handed in. And so you mailed the paperwork in, but people were only going by the office like once a week or once every 2 weeks to pick up the mail. So even if your documents got there in 2 days, it could have been like another week or so before they actually got them in their hands. So everything got drawn out and drawn out and drawn out. And my sister, being a strong woman of faith, she hung in there. You know, and I used to pray every day, you know, that he would be with her. So on top of dealing with that, her husband wound up needing a heart transplant. So basically, after dealing with my mother and finally laying her to rest, it was like we drove up. It was just like a surreal thing, because all the chairs were like 6 feet apart in the funeral home, and for the viewing, only two people could walk in at a time. So you had two people walk in, and there was a time limit, and you had to come back out, and the next two people couldn't walk in until the other two people walked. It was just the weirdest thing I had ever experienced. But like I said, then my sister, her husband needed a heart transplant, which had to be done in Connecticut. She lives in New Jersey. So on top of everything else, she was traveling back and forth between Connecticut and New Jersey on a weekly basis to see him. And I know that as much as I was praying, I knew that she was praying as well. But even in those times when things like seem to happen and everything seems like it's toppling over, you know, God is always still there. My brother-in-law is fine. He's, you know, doing better than most expected with his new heart. My sister, she's still, matter of fact, I think she's leading worship this morning at her church. So she's still, you know, she's still there. But A lot of times I think we get to the point where God almost becomes like an ATM. You know, we call on him when we need him. And then when we don't need him, he's just like sort of out of sight, out of mind. But I believe that a constant reminder of everything that we go through every day is that without God, none of us are doing what we're doing right now. I mean, I believe we're all here due to God's grace, that if it wasn't for him being with us, that we wouldn't be able to get up and come here and worship and praise him. And the testimonies you heard here, you know, nobody can, the saying is we're overcome by our testimony, that nobody can tell you what you've gone through. And I think that that's why it's so important that every once in a while, and I'm even going to, because Pastor came up with this idea, but I think we should do this on a more regular basis, where we allow people to come and share their testimonies and share how God is working in their lives. Because if not, then it gets to a point where, you know, Sunday morning, 11 o'clock, what do? You come to church, you know, you say hello to everybody, stand in the aisle, sing a couple songs, then you go home. But I think without that constant reminder that God is real and he's here and he's working in our lives is something that we all need. So, yeah, I saw you raise your hand. Okay, well, please share with us.
So I didn't come up before because there are so many testimonies of things that God did to me, I couldn't choose one. But the best one is what he did for my dad. And I'll try to get through it without crying. I didn't make it through the funeral, but I'll try my best to get through this. My dad was a non-believer for a long time. Well, he was baptized as a child, but he didn't know what it meant. His brother, my Uncle Alan, got saved and he went Jesus crazy. And so he turned my dad off a lot because he was doing things like, oh, you can't chew that gum without saying a prayer first. And I mean, he was like over the top. And he admitted that at my dad's funeral, that he probably drove my dad away from Jesus for a while. But my dad was very sick at the end of his life. He had an accident in 1985 where he fell through a skylight and he had all kind of damage to his body. And he went well for years getting through it, being okay. And then he started having to be on pain meds and his body started disintegrating and bones were breaking easy. And at the end, he was in a wheelchair and right up the street. And a lot of people would see him because he smoked his whole life. They would see him out on the bench smoking a cigarette and they would wave. And my dad used to tell me, don't preach at me. Don't preach at me. Just because you believe, you don't preach at me. And my brother, became a believer, the same thing happened. Dad's like, y'all are just Jesus freaks, blah, blah, blah. Well, then about the last year of his life, when I was traveling to his apartment while he lived at home in a wheelchair and I was taking care of him after work, and my brother came down to help him with stuff, and he was out of state, and my dad started asking questions. And about the last 5 months, 6 months of his life, though he was in and out from, they thought he had dementia, but I think it was the morphine, he started asking questions and he started begging God to please take him. And he said, why is he leaving me here like this? Why isn't he answering my prayers? And I said, I don't know, Dad. Did you accept Jesus as your Savior? Did you tell God that you believed he was his son? And he said, no, how do you do that? So I walked him through it and I prayed with him and he said the prayer and
Then my brother did it on the phone 2 or 3 times with him, and when my dad finally understood exactly what he was doing and what Jesus was and what God expected of him, 2 weeks later he passed. So God's timing is not our timing. He has a reason for it, and I thank him for waiting before he took my dad.
Amen. 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 Thank you for sharing that, Joyce. Thank you for sharing that. So, see, it doesn't matter what we think. Oh, come on. It doesn't matter what we think. Just like the prodigal son.
Hi. Ray finally pushed me out of my seat. But, when I went through a lot of stuff on my own, I mean, in my body, and I went through 2 marriages, 9 children, 8 to, I have born 4, 5 stepchildren, and then 1 more makes 4 that I born. Anyhow, I thank God for leading my doctor to take care of me, because I had a fallen rectum and they sewed that back to place. I had ulcer colitis and had cancer in one of the polyps, and they got it before it leaked. I had blood clot go to my lung. I've fallen at least 7, 8, 9 times, and every time I'd fall, I had no feeling from waist down. I mean, none at all. I would crawl with my arms to the couch, and my son-in-law took my legs, put me on the couch, and I did not feel any of it. I just seen them with my ankles, but I couldn't feel anything. I went from the bathroom to about there, and I fainted. I mean, I blacked out, and I must have hit the bottom of my bed. I woke up, so thank God for that. And when I fall and everything, Ray has been helping me, you know, to the car and out of the car, to the church, back to the car. So, I mean, I just help. I went with his father, and he was my companion, and he would bring food to me. When I was here at daycare, take me home, feed me, and bring me back. And I just, God led me. I feel 99% better than I did when I was younger. So God bless everybody, and God bless him for leading my doctor to help me. Thank you.
Amen. 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 Young man, come share with us.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
In 2022, my dad had a surgery. Got a surgery, sorry. It was a day I was worried, stressed, and I felt everything. I started crying, and I prayed to God that everything went well, and he may make it well. Thank you.
Thank you. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Change the tone just a little bit here, but I want to say a word of appreciation for and testify about some of the things that happened here behind the scenes. And if I start down this list, it can't end, but a lot of people are doing things behind the scenes. But one thing I'm thinking about, particularly this morning, One of the things that somebody does is somebody puts out the service program a few days before church. Somebody. I'm not real consistent on it, but I like looking in there and looking up the passage that is cited and do a little Bible study to kind of look at it, and then I kind of spend a little time wondering, you know, what the pastor's going to say, and I almost never get it right. So I don't know if anybody else does that. Did anybody else look at this morning's passage? Okay, so I'm not the only one. But here's something, and this is for the pastor. If you're listening to this morning, pastor, something I'm wondering about that I don't know if you would have brought it up or not, but in one of the verses in the passage, they named the 12 apostles, the 12 disciples. And I'm going through there, and a lot of you know, names I'm real familiar with. You know, there's Simon Peter, and then there's another Simon, there's Thomas, and there's Matthew, and the brother named, yeah, there you go. And there's one name probably in the next verse, Thaddeus. And I go, Thaddeus? Who's Thaddeus? And I don't know anything about Thaddeus. Pastor? What do we know about Thaddeus?
So the challenge has been set out.
Who's that guy?
Anyone else? This is a blessed time. It is. And it doesn't matter how old you are, from the youngest to the oldest. God loves it when you acknowledge him, because that's what he wants. That's what he really wants. As I was about to say earlier, you know, when the prodigal son returned, and you know, as he was returning, he was putting together his apology speech. He was getting everything ready. And his father didn't even care. His father said, he's come home. So we're going to celebrate the fact that he's come home. And that's what it's all about. So we all know people that we wish would give their life to Christ or can't figure out why they wouldn't. And that's not up to us to worry about. All we need to do is be that witness to them. And being that witness doesn't mean running around behind them with a Bible and beating them over the head. That means you expressing your life in a Christ-like way, and then let God work. And God will do the work. And when you least expect it, like you said, when you least expect it, that question will come, you know. Where my stepfather used to listen to me and my sister when we would have our discussions before he passed away. And we could always tell because we would be in the dining room and he'd be in the kitchen. He'd sort of be like listening like this, you know. He'd be listening. So now I don't even know. I mean, he never came to me and my sister, you know, but just the idea that, you know, he was listening, you know. And some of you may know people like that around you who you figure, you know, they're not paying attention, you know, but they're listening and they're watching. And they're usually the first ones to point out, hey, ain't you a Christian? Why are you doing this? Why are you doing that? So they're paying attention and they're watching. So just know that God is using you, each and every one of you, in your own little way to be that witness. Amen? Amen, amen. I want to thank everybody who came up and shared their testimony. And for those who We're probably a little bit nervous or scared. Don't worry, it'll be another time. We'll call you up another time because we're definitely going to be doing this again. So at this time, we want to do our closing song, which is Mighty to Save, because He is mighty to save. So let us join together in singing.
Heroes and conquered the grave.
Amen, amen. Shine your light. Let the whole world see the glory of the risen King. Let us now be dismissed with God's blessing. Father, we thank you today for allowing us to come together to praise and worship you. And Father, we pray that when we leave here, that your Spirit leaves with us. And let us shine, Father, let us shine, so that somebody who doesn't know you, even if they don't get to know you, they'll have questions and they will ask, Father. And we are here to be your ambassadors and to bring forth your kingdom here on earth. We pray these things in Son's Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Amen.
I struggle, keep you near the cross, and may your troubles show that you need God, and may your battles end the way they should, and may your bad days prove that God is good, and may your whole life prove that God is good.
Be blessed, everyone. Be blessed.